Hi everyone, my name is Kevin. Welcome to episode 4 of How to Talk About the Bible and LGBTQ Inclusion. This episode, we're going to be talking about gender complementarity and how most people don't even really know what they're talking about when they say gender complementarity. So one big argument that gets thrown around as to why we can't allow for the affirmation of same-sex relationship is that same-sex relationships violate a divinely ordered gender complementary that's obvious in the Bible. To put it bluntly, God made Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve, y'all. Think about gender complementarity is that it's a set of social norms, not a biblical teaching. If we're being honest, gender complementarity is more of a category and less of an argument. It says that there are differences and similarities between the genders, but it doesn't exactly state what that pattern is. And generally, what many times I found when I'm having conversations with people is that when they talk about gender complementarity, they don't exactly understand what even they're talking about. There's roughly three ways that gender complementarity arguments kind of like pan out. The first idea is called complementarianism, and it's the basic idea that men are divinely ordered to lead and women are to follow. This is a product of the good old-fashioned patriarchy. The writers of the Bible lived in a very certain time with a very certain set of gender roles that came from culture, not from God. And many Christians today don't even follow the explicit gender roles that are outlined in certain passages in the Bible. Overall, the New Testament is actually giving us a vision for what the kingdom of heaven is going to be like, where the hierarchy of men over women is done away with. And it says in Galatians 3:28 that in Christ Jesus there is slave nor free, Jew nor Gentile, male nor female. The idea that men should be leading and women should be following is, you know, kind of outdated, and we can have a whole conversation about patriarchy later, but in my opinion and the opinions of many other scholars, that's a moot point. Second argument that comes up is about procreation and procreative complementarity. In this line of thinking, it's talking about specifically sex and that sex should be only used for procreation. And since same-sex couples can't procreate on their own, people will say, well, that goes against nature. But I don't even think many straight couples would be down with this line of thinking, because think about it. Every time you have sex, it better be for making a baby, otherwise it's unholy. But let's take this thought exercise a little bit further. Let's say that there is a heterosexual couple and one of the partners is sterile. Does that mean anytime that they have sex it's unholy, or that it violates nature, or that their marriage is invalid just because they can't conceive a child? Or what about a couple who has had children and then the woman goes through menopause one day? Should they just stop having sex because she can't get pregnant any longer because of what is naturally occurring in her body? Is their marriage then invalid because she is no longer fertile? Or what about a couple who gets married later in life, way past the woman's childbearing years? Is that marriage invalid? Should they never ever have sex just because the woman can't get pregnant? Or if the man can't get it up? So yeah, in my opinion and the opinion of, again, many scholars, procreative complementarity is not a valid argument to hold up against discriminating against same-sex couples and relationships. This next one is my favorite, and it's anatomical complementarity. Some folks would crudely put this as the issue of plumbing, that a round peg fits into a round hole. We're talking about penises and vaginas, by the way. That the argument is that anatomically speaking, a penis fits into a vagina, and therefore it's obvious. It's obvious in creation, like what God intended us to use our bodies for. Right? Show me in the Bible where it says that. Show me where it says that a round peg fits into a round hole, so to speak. Show me where it says that you have to use, you know, these parts of our anatomy simply for this one act. Newsflash, you're not gonna find it. Now, one might point out the Genesis story. It says that God created them male and female, he created them. When people look at the Genesis story and see male and female, they will argue that the union of male and female is needed in order to more accurately or more greatly reflect the image of God, since the image of God is present in both male and female, and that this is the only way in order to fully embody the image of God is in a heterosexual marriage. But what about Jesus? I think Jesus was the ultimate contradiction to this notion, because the Jesus revealed to us in scripture and in life is the ultimate reflection of God. Am I wrong? And Jesus was never married. If we are all called to be Christ-like, then we all have the capacity to reflect the full divine image in and of ourselves without being married to a partner, gay, straight, or otherwise. And then people are going to go at you and say, well, what about one flesh, one flesh? In Genesis 2:24, it says, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and cling unto his wife, and they shall become one flesh. The word one flesh is the Hebrew word echad. Echad. All of my friends who actually do speak Hebrew and went to seminary, I apologize if I butchered that word. Echad is actually the cardinal number in Hebrew for one. And the thing about that is, it's not talking about sex. It's not talking about a penis and a vagina. It's talking about deep, interconnectedness at its deepest level. It's talking about a kinship bond that should never, ever be broken. And even when Jesus was talking about divorce in Matthew 19, where he quotes Genesis 2 again, I don't think Jesus again is talking about, again, penises and vaginas fitting a certain way together. I think Jesus is talking about and reaffirming this idea that there's a deep kinship bond that should not be severed. And while this right here leads to a deeper discussion about marriage and divorce, it doesn't say anything exclusively about a universal gender complementarity. So things to keep in mind when you're talking to somebody about gender complementarity, you need to make sure you know what they're talking about and they know what they're talking about, especially because this argument doesn't have a lot of really solid scriptural grounding. Two questions that you can ask right off the bat are, one, what exact aspect of gender complementarity is violated by intimate same-sex relationship? And the second, where in scripture exactly do you find this exact universal description of gender complementarity? But y'all, the devil is in the details. Or maybe the liberation of queer people is in the details. I don't know. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, go ahead and like, share, and subscribe. Go ahead and click on that playlist over there or over there. I never get that right. And you can watch the entire series of how to talk about LGBTQ inclusion in the Bible, and go ahead and connect with me on social media down below and on the blog and on Patreon and all the things. I'd love to connect with you. And yeah, leave a comment below. I'd love to know how you're processing these things. I'd also love if you have any questions to leave them below so I can answer them in later videos. Thank you so much for watching this, and I look forward to talking to you next time. Bye.